उन्हनि जे एलजीअ जे हैसियत में तव्हां वटि हिकिड़ी सौगात खणी आयो आहियां। उहा सौगात आहे मुंहिंजे सिंधी समाज जी तव्हांजे लाइ आरज़ू, तव्हांजे लाइ दुआ। हिते ई जिते बि हुजे हुजो, उते वधंदा रहो। दुनिया जा सभु लुत्फ़ चङी तरह माणियो ऐं जेको ई मुश्किल कमु तव्हां हथ में खयो आहे त सिंधियत खे क़ाइमु रखणो आहे, सिंधियत खे ज़िंदह रखणो आहे, इन्हीअ में तव्हांखे पूरी सफलता मिले। इहा सौगात सिंधी समाज जी मां तव्हां वटि खणी तव्हांजी झोलीअ में रखण थो चाहियां ऐं उमेदु आहे त इहा सौगात तव्हां क़बूलु कंदा। दोस्तो, मुंहिंजे वाक्षत में घणियूं ॻाल्हियूं दोस्त चयूं, पर मूंखे हिकिड़ी शिकायत आहे, मुंहिंजी पूरी सुञाणप कान थी। मां पंहिंजी सुञाणप पाण थो करणु थो चाहियां। मुंहिंजी वॾे में वॾी सुञाणप इहा आहे त जेतोणीक मूंखे हालतुनि पाकिस्तान मां कढी हिंदुस्तान जे हिकु रेफ्यूजी कैम्प में ज़िंदगी शुरू करणी पई, तॾहिं मुंहिंजे खून में कावड़ का बि गुसो का बि इंतकाम जो ख़्यालु कॾहिं कोन आयो। ऐं मां उन्हनि माण्हुनि मां आहियां जॾहिं मां शरणार्थी कैम्प में रहियल हुउसि त मूं हिकिड़ो दृढ़ वीचार कयो, पाण सां फ़ैसिलो कयो हो त जेकॾहिं हिंदुस्तान ऐं पाकिस्तान पाण में एतिरा दोस्त न थींदा जो हक़ ॿिए खे पाण खे ठाकुर में पकिड़े, प्यार ऐं मोहबत जे ठाकुर में पकिड़े जेकॾहिं गुज़रान न कंदा त ॿई मुल्क बर्बादु थी वेंदा। इन मौक़ुम इरादे सां मां पंहिंजी ज़िंदगी हिंदुस्तान में हलाई आहे ऐं मां इहा दावा करणु थो चाहियां, जेका दावा शायदि ताईं क़बूलु कंदा, त हिंदुस्तान में पाकिस्तान खे मूंखां वधीक ॿियो को दोस्त न आहे। आई एम नॉट अ मैन ऑफ रिलीजन, हर कंहिंखे अधिकार आहे, हर कंहिंखे हक़ आहे जंहिं जंहिं मज़हब जो कोयल आहे, बेशक उहो पंहिंजे मज़हब जे पुठियां हले ऐं मज़हब खे वधाए। ही शुड प्रोफेस प्रैक्टिस एंड इवन प्रोपेगेटेड, दैट इज़ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल राइट टू आई एक्सेप्ट। आई रिस्पेक्ट ऑल रिलीजन्स, आई रिस्पेक्ट ऑल मेन ऑफ रिलीजन, but I am free to confess that in my opinion religion has a very negative balance sheet. I don't think it is a great exaggeration if I say that all the ships of all the navies of the world can swim comfortably in the ocean of innocent blood which has been shared in the name of religion throughout the history of mankind. While I respect other people's religion, I have evolved my own one-line religion. And my one-line religion is that make as many people happy as you can while you live. Of all religions, and particularly the religion of Islam. I believe that every religion has a core, its essence. Tat purch jage jage, understand the essence of Islam perhaps differently from most Muslims do. I believe that the Prophet of Islam was the greatest prophet because he is the one prophet who told his followers that the ink of the scholar is more valuable than the blood of a martyr. When the angel of God visited him in his dream, he told him, read, read, read. The prophet said, but I can't read. He said, no, read, read, read. And ladies and gentlemen, the prophet understood that this was a command of God, that at least I must ask my followers to read. That is precisely what he did. Muslims rose from one height to a greater height when they followed the teaching of the Prophet. It is said that in ancient times there were 36 public libraries in the city of Baghdad alone. A Muslim divine was invited by the Khalifa to go and live in his palace. He declined the offer. When the Khalifa asked, but why not? I give you all the conveniences to pursue your scholarship. Come and write, come and read. Oh, he says, sir, no, I won't come. Why? He says, I require 400 camels to transport my books. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Islam at its height. And there is no other prophet of any religion who told his followers that please think that you have to become scholars. Go in search of knowledge. When you go in search of knowledge, you walk in the path of God. It's a tragedy. It's a tragedy that Muslims, and I say it with all the love and affection which I have for my Muslim friends, that Muslims forgot the teaching of the Prophet. Islam and Muslims of the world civilized Europe. You brought Europe out of the darkness in which it had plunged. But I have often asked my Muslim friends, please tell me, have you understood the mystery? Why is it that you became the slaves of those whom you civilized? You gave them the light of knowledge, and yet they went forward and captivated practically the whole world of Islam, leave a few nations aside. Ladies and gentlemen, the tragedy has been that Muslims ultimately decided to burn books. In the 12th century, you burned the books of Avinash, Avicenna. After 40 years, you burned the books of Averroes. The study of philosophy became a crime, punishable in some countries. And ever since then, ladies and gentlemen, Islam has not risen to the glory which it rightly deserves and rightly belongs. So ladies and gentlemen, I heard some speeches this morning in the first session, before this session. Somebody used the expression, Pakistan mein ya Sindh mein, taleem ki tabahi hogi. That is the tragedy, ladies and gentlemen. No democracy can survive without education. Democracy without education is hypocrisy without limitation. But ladies and gentlemen, please do not leave education in the charge of politicians. While I was walking in this mall, I came across one small little shop. They are selling printed slogans. One of the slogans which I found printed and very prominent
It said that diapers and politicians must be frequently changed. That is not so humiliating. The humiliating is the reason which follows. Diapers and politicians must be frequently changed, but for the same reason. So, ladies and gentlemen, I plead guilty to the charge of being a politician in some sense. I have been a politician. I am a politician. But I am a politician who regards politics as a sacred game, a sacred science, and a sacred art. It is a sacred science because it believes in finding out the ways of locating the sinews and the centers of power in whose hands they ought to be. It is an art which prevents the wealth of the poor man getting into the pockets of corrupt politicians. The politicians and education have a conflict of interest. Once the voter becomes educated and intelligent, he begins to ask the question, why am I poor and why are you rich? The politician is not prepared to answer these difficult questions. The politician, therefore, has a vested interest in keeping the voter uneducated. And all the laws that you pass about freedom of information is ultimately, ladies and gentlemen, nothing at all. My friend delivered a long lecture upon the Constitution of Pakistan and the changes which you want. You may keep arguing about constitutional provisions and laws, but ultimately, ladies and gentlemen, constitutions and laws don't matter. What matters is the character of the human beings who run the institutions which the law creates and runs the institutions which the Constitution creates. I regret to say that both in India and in Pakistan, we are facing a common problem. And the common problem is that the average run of the politician is a betrayer of the trust of the people of this country and people of both countries. And it is these politicians who must be discarded like diapers, as the printed slogan in this mall itself tells us. So, ladies and gentlemen, I am now to turn to the youngster here. We old people have sinned. These youngsters, जो हमारे मुस्तकबिल के मालिक, I turn to them because they are the only hope left. I have one thought to share with them, that please have the courage of speaking the truth. Treat all men in power with great suspicion and mistrust. Don't convert men in power into gods. Keep analyzing them. Keep asking them inconvenient questions. The tragedy has been that our youngsters themselves have remained silent when they should be loudly asking questions, to the embarrassment of those people who run our destinies with their hands. We are going through a very, very delicate situation today. It's a world which is very dangerous. Yeh sitam ka daur, sitam ke daur mein wo ahle Delhi kaam aaye. Zabaan pe naaz tha jinko wo bezabaan nikle. If our youngsters do not learn and pick up the courage of speaking the truth. Truth in the front and in the presence of the people of power. Democracy will never survive. Freedom will wither away and freedom will disappear from your hands. And the future will remain the dark future that you now see. I believe that the young man of today
will have justified his youth and would have done his duty to the nation if at the end of his life he could justly say to himself in all conscience, na sir chupa ke jiye, na sir jhuka ke jiye, sitam garon ke nazar se nazar mila ke jiye, ab agar ek raat kam jiye to kabhi sahi, yehi bahut hai ki mashale jala ke jiye. Dosto, I saw the youngsters yesterday who had been asked to write an essay on Sindh. They were small little children. They did a wonderful job. Then I saw those five youngsters whose speeches I heard. I must admit that at their age, I was not half as clever as I found them to be. But ladies and gentlemen, even they suffer from want of adequate knowledge of what Sindh stands for, what Sindhiyat means, and what is it that you are trying to preserve and to perpetuate. First, have you understood the essence of the Sindhiyat that you are talking about? I'm glad that you are talking about it. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know how many of you have heard a great Sindhi writer, a lady by the name of Bhakti Hiranandani. She wrote a book called Sindhis, the Scattered Treasure. It's a great book that every one of you must read if you have not read it already. But ladies and gentlemen, I have written an introduction for that book. When you read that book, you read the introduction too. But I am not advertising my introduction. I am advertising another great writer who belongs to the Nehru family. She was the daughter of Vijayalakshmi Pandit, Nayanthara Sehgal. She is a great author, a great, great writer, and a great intellectual in India. She reviewed that book. And ladies and gentlemen, I want the youngsters here to read with me and to understand what the review of that book says. All Indians are heirs to the Indus Valley civilization, but Sindhis are its natural heirs, coming from this region where it began and prospered and made its mark in the ancient world as perhaps the most superior civilization of its day. The book acquaints us with the living impact of this heritage, enriched by Arab and Persian influences upon her community. Nayanthara Sehgal is not a Sindhi. She's talking of Popti's community, her community. She enables us to link the highly organized cities, the talented craftsmen, and the seafaring merchants of 7,000 years ago with the enterprising cosmopolitan Sindhi we know, who ventures forth into all parts of the world and feels at home even more and everywhere. The book leaves upon its readers two clear impressions. One is the secular outlook of the Sindhi, who draws his language, culture, and inspiration from both Hindu and Muslim streams. The other is that the Sindhi has made the transition to modernity more successfully than most other Indians. He cherishes his traditions, the Sindhi cherishes his traditions, yet is in every sense a modern human being. Both achievements are more remarkable when we realize that unlike every other Indian community, the Sindhis since partition have had no stretch of land to call their own. We Sindhis who left Pakistan are, ladies and gentlemen, left without a territory of our own. There is no Sindh for us. The whole of India is our Sindh. But coming here, I realize that your tragedy perhaps is greater, that while you have a land which was your own, it has ceased to be your land in some sense, even though you are physically occupying that land. I sympathize with you, ladies and gentlemen. But from this Nayantara Sehgal's book and this small little introduction to that review of that book, you realize that the Sindhi Tehzeeb, the Sindhi Sindhyat that you are talking about, the Sindhi Sabhyata, uske do nishani, par nishani hai mein, jin ke tha ke kaam rakhna hai, ek andruni nishani hai, andruni nishani hai, ta khuda ji paida kail khalq sa mohabbat, and unha ji khizmat, bhi aaye bahari, sa aaye sa nishandar boli. Professor Shah, आपने ठीक कहा. जब ये मैं पाकिस्तान से बाहर आ रहा था तो उन्होंने कहा कि कुछ सूट बना के देख लेगा, मगर मैंने कहा कि मैं नहीं सूट पहनूंगा, मैं अपनी पोशाक में जाऊंगा. मैं माफी चाहता हूं कि मैं ऐसी लिबास में हूं आज, मगर पहले दिन जब भी मां यहां आया मैं आप जैसा लिबास पहन के आया. मैंने देखा कि कोई नहीं पहनता, मैंने इसका त्याग कर दिया. तभी मैं आज इसी लिबास में हूं, मैं माफी चाहता हूं. दोस्तों, दिस सिंधिया अब बच्चा है, गिव यू द टू वर्च्यूज, इज नॉट वर्थ लिविंग फॉर अनलेस इट इज वर्थ डाइंग फॉर. बहादुरी सां उन्हें निशानन की बर्दाश्त कंदासी, कदें भी उन्हें के दाजी या फिको थियण न ॾींदासीं. ऐं दोस्तो, कहिड़ी बि मुसीबत साम्हूं अचे, कहिड़ी बि ताक़त साम्हूं अचे, उन जो पंहिंजे खून सां, पंहिंजी रत वहाए उन जो मुक़ाबिलो कंदासीं ऐं उन जो पराजय कंदासीं. तारा सेगल चयो त हीअ जेका असांजी सिंधियत आहे, दैट लिंक्स यू विथ द एंशंट वर्ल्ड ऑफ 7000 ईयर्स अगो. अलेक्ज़ेंडर द ग्रेट केम ओनली अबाउट 300 or 400 ईयर्स बिफोर द क्रिश्चियन एरा, बट ही एनकाउंटर्ड अवर एंसेस्टर्स ऑन द बैंक ऑफ द इंडस. Alexander himself was a philosopher and a student of Aristotle. So he used to have a flair for discussing things with other people who claimed to be philosophers. So he saw these Sindhi fakirs, naked fakirs. The historians call them the gymnosophists of the world. He entered into a conversation with them. So one of them asked him, he said, but why have you come here? You say that you have come from a distant place called Macedon. Why have you come here? And he said, but I am on a mission of world conquest. The moment he said that, all these fakirs, naked fakirs, started laughing hysterically in his face. They laughed until Alexander said that either they are mad or I am mad. Something is wrong. They told him finally that don't be such a fool. You can't conquer the world. You require 6 feet of space to bury you. We don't even bury our dead. We burn them here. We don't require even that space that you are talking about. Ladies and gentlemen, the Western historians have reported that Alexander thought that he had come to the end of the earth and therefore he went back. No, he did not go back. He saw the miles and miles of earth in front of him on the other side of Indus. He was not such a fool that he thought that this is the end of the earth. It is our ancestors who sent him back.
Wow.
He tried to ask them that you come with me to Macedon. I want to take you, come and live in my palace. They said nothing of the kind. We are very happy here where we are. You go back to Macedon. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know how many of you are aware that ultimately with great difficulty he persuaded one chap to go with him. And his name was Kalinas. Kalinas went with him. But when they reached the next city in Iran, Kalinas developed some temperature. So he walked up to Alexander and said, listen, my religion tells me that if my body is not very firm, if I become infirm, I have no right to live. So Alexander said, but what do you propose to do? He said, now you see what I am going to do. He lit up a fire, and the historians record that he ascended into the funeral pyre without batting an eyelid. He burned himself to the amazement of the Greek army. But he whispered into Alexander's ears that don't worry, I am going to meet you in the next city. Ladies and gentlemen, Alexander never reached Macedon. He died in the next city. I'm sure Kalinas met him. He was one of our ancestors. So ladies and gentlemen, at least the historians of the world believe that civilization started with the Greeks. But in 1924, a miracle happened. Again, the miracle happened in Sindh. When those excavations of Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa disclosed to us a civilization much superior to any existing civilization at that time, a superior civilization to all civilizations that mankind had witnessed in there. Ladies and gentlemen, it was cities over cities. The more deep you go, the greater is the advancement of that civilization that you witness. They had big roads and shops on both sides. They had a well in every house. They had underground drainage. They had swimming pools. And ladies and gentlemen, thau ka bartan, zalim de singaran ko sahulatiyo, pottery painted and plain, kadim zamane ja sika, chandi and sone ja zevar, terracotta dyes, kangan, chudiyo, malao, kannan jo mundiyo, वधीक सुणियूं जेके शयूं अॼु तव्हांखे वॾनि वॾनि दुकाननि में मिलंदियूं ऐं कारीगर जेके असांजे अॼुकल्ह जे कारीगरनि खां होशियार. लेडीज़ एंड जेंटलमैन, वन ऑफ द फाइंड्स, द मोस्ट प्रेशियस फाइंड हैज़ अट्रैक्टेड द अटेंशन ऑफ अ ब्रिटिश हिस्टोरियन. It was an artifact which people have not yet been able to understand. The most precious thing that they found was a small statuette of a dancing girl. This has amazed scholars who have been struggling to understand the artifacts that were found in Mohenjo-Daro. It is a girl who is flaunting her puberty, who is practically wearing nothing except a chunk of jewelry. She is obviously wanting to be desired, and she should be happy to know that after thousands of years,
we still desire that.
So, ladies and gentlemen, this is the civilization of 7,000 years ago. And no wonder, some years ago, with my friend Neil Vidwani sitting here, we inaugurated the Institute of Sindhology in Chicago. It has now attracted the attention of the US government. And believe you me, we are hoping that there may be a good bit of financial grants from the American government. But in the meantime, the Japanese have taken interest in this. And they have produced a whole book and a whole cassette, which I believe Neil has got it. And please take it from him and see what Monjodaro really means. It's the Japanese who have taken charge of it, and I hope it will be a part of your Sindhyat program, and you will certainly take charge of it. And ladies and gentlemen, the essence of Sindhyat is secularism. I am a secularist. As I said, I respect religions. But the trouble is that religion has always been in conflict with science. Science poses questions which cannot be answered. But religion gives you answers which cannot be questioned. Got this small little equipment which we mammals have. We must think only with this. The greatest contribution of Sindh was not Sufism, but Akbar the Great. Akbar was born in Sindh. He was the greatest gift of God, not only to the Mughal Empire, but to the whole of India. What happened in his court? He collected the greatest philosophers and heads of religion. They discussed threadbare every religion, every religious practice, every religious belief. They discussed it with great courtesy. Nobody plunged a knife into somebody's neck. Nobody killed another. Nobody issued a fatwa of death. They discussed religion, ladies and gentlemen. And each was free to propound the greatness of his religion if he wanted to. But on what do you judge the greatness of a religion? On what turned the arguments of these people who assembled in the court of Akbar? The arguments turned ultimately upon this. They argued with their reasoning power that this dogma, this practice, this belief is superior to the beliefs of others. Ultimately, secularism is the superiority of this small little brain of ours, and on the anvil of that brain must be tested the validity of every religious doctrine. And ladies and gentlemen, you might also wonder that before Pakistan was created, a resolution in favor of Pakistan had to be passed through the assemblies of the various provinces. Jinnah could not get the Pakistan resolution passed in the Sindh Assembly. I don't know how many of you are aware of this historical fact. There was a slender majority, a majority of one. Khan Bahadur, in those days, he had given up his Khan Bahadurship. Alabak Sundro was the chief minister of Sindh. And the Pakistan resolution could not be passed. And ultimately, Alabaksh had to be disposed of by an hired assassin's bullet. And the Pakistan resolution was passed by a majority of one. The speaker, the governor, Sir Francis Moody, casting vote in favor of Pakistan resolution. Ladies and gentlemen, I must also share with you one personal fact which nobody knows. I often speak about it. People ask me, who created Pakistan? Pakistan was created by a Hindu miser.
in Karachi.
Jinnah Sahib, when he qualified for the bar, he came to Karachi to practice because there was a large Koja community there, and he thought that he will get a good bit of clientele in Karachi. Ladies and gentlemen, he went to the firm of Harchandra and Company, a famous firm in Karachi in those days. And old Harchandra interviewed him and told him that, "Mr. Jinnah, you are welcome to join my office. You are highly qualified and we welcome you." So then started the question of money. Now in those days, the rupee had a value. Mr. Jinnah asked for 100 rupees per month. That old miser would not go beyond 75. On this, the talks broke. That Hindu miser, if he had paid 25 rupees more, India would not have been partnership. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is. I wish Harchandra had paid 25 rupees. I would not have heard all this which I have been hearing today about sin. Anyway, yes. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is where we stand. Siddhis love good life. They are also the followers of Ghalib. Ghalib, jisne kaha tha, ko haath ko jumbish nahi, magar aankhon mein to dam hai. आंखों में तो दम है, अरे रहने दो अभी सागरों की ना मेरे आगे. I see that the Sindhi crowd here has been enjoying Ghalib Shah's teaching, and I was very happy that I joined them on two nights. And we have seen Sindh and Sindhra at its best. And ladies and gentlemen, I was supposed to stop at 7:15, I'm told, because you have to wind up these things. I have a lot to say to you, but I will say it some other time. In the meantime, let me thank you again. God bless.
जुंगन संदी जार तिनी जी सांजार त्रो थे तार साईं रामजीवन सचनता खुदा जी खल्क कैल खल्क सा मोहब्बत ऐं उन जी किस्मत ऐं सिंधी बोली ये ब आहिनि उसूल असांजा हुजणु खपनि एंड दे आर वर्थ डाइंग फॉर एसेंस ऑफ सिंधियत इज सेक्युलरिज़म ऐं हिकु लाइन पंहिंजो रिलीजन चयो अथनि मुझे ख्याल में तवाजी ख्वाहिश हूँ तो साई के वरी बुद्धासे पर हिंसर सतें बजे खाली करो न तो चवन डिनर न मिलती है जवाब सो हाँ सो ये खत्म कर गाल से बुझाया साई राम लक्ष्मणी लिखो है आई हैव ओनली वन लाइन रीजन एंड दैट इज वी मस्ट लिव अ लाइफ गाइडेड बाय रीजन बट इंस्पायर्ड बाय लव पान बुझाऊँ तो जी खलक खुश रखी सके इन इजलास से खत्म था करियो उनका आग में एजाज शेयर कर दो
सही एक काम था करो शाह जी ने बैठ था सजन ऐ साणे सजन ऐ साणे के 78 विसरे 78 निभा सजन ऐ साणे के 78 विसरे है तनी ते होए वतन जनु साजे
साईं डिनर जे लाइ हॉल 8 बजे खोलींदा।